Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anupama, professor at Department of Economics, Punjabi University, Patiala. I am going to talk about the module Current Urban Policy Initiatives from Population, Urbanization and Poverty. So students, we are going to discuss about the policy initiatives in developed and transition economies. City life is naturally associated with better amenities and opportunities. But this is also not free of the challenges which are faced by the citizens as well as the policymakers. While the citizens struggle for their livelihoods, the policymakers face a number of issues ranging from the economy to welfare, climate, and the safety of the citizens. The urban policy, in this sense, is a technical and political process concerned with the use of land and design of the urban environment, including transportation networks, to guide and ensure the orderly development of settlements and communities where the benefits are justifiably distributed. During the process of urbanization, the challenges and risks would be higher and the opportunities fewer if the urban growth is not managed properly. In recent decades, the urban areas and the process of urbanization has undergone a massive change. Initially, urbanization was considered a feature of the developed countries only, and within that, the urban issues were related with metropolitan areas only. But now, the urbanization process is more of a developing country phenomenon, and the issues are more related with middle-weight and small-sized cities. This has posed new challenges before the urban policy makers. So in this perspective, this module aims to throw light on urban policy, why a policy is needed, global urban planning issues, recent issues of urban policy initiatives in developing countries, urban policy issues in transitional economies, urban policy issues in developed countries, and urban policy initiatives for prosperity of the city. We will also discuss the impediments before the prosperity of the city. Let us first define urban policy. But before defining an urban policy, the question is, what is policy in its first place? A policy is typically described as a principle or rule to guide decisions and achieve rational outcomes. Policy is not normally used to denote what is actually done. What is actually done is normally referred to as either procedure or protocol. A policy can be considered as a statement of intent or a commitment. For that reason, at least the decision makers can be held accountable for their policy. The term may apply to government, private sector organizations and groups, and the individuals. Policy differs from rule of law. While rules of law can compel or prohibit behaviors, for example, a law requiring the payments of taxes or income, policy merely guides action towards those that are most likely to achieve a desired outcome, often for the greatest common good or the least harm if one were to have to undergo it. Policies frequently have side effects because environments that policies seek to influence or manipulate are typically complex adaptive systems. For example, the government, societies, large companies. Making a policy change can have counterintuitive results. Now, looking in this perspective, we can define an urban policy. UN Habitat 2014 defines an urban policy as a coherent set of decisions derived through a deliberate government-led process of coordinating and rallying various actors for a common vision and goal that will promote more transformative, productive, inclusive, and resilient urban development for the long term, which can be from 20 to 30 or even 100 years horizon. An urban policy is an interactive process that could have at least four phases. These are the diagnostic phase, the formulation phase, implementation phase, and monitoring and evaluation phase. As the figure suggests, that any urban policy diagnoses the problems and threats of urbanization and formulates the remedial measures which are implemented through various institutions, and then the outcomes are monitored. If there are still lags in the targets and the outcomes, the problems are again diagnosed and the process goes on. The question is why a policy is needed. The projections of urban population growth around the world tell us that between 2000 and 2050, the amount of urban space will need to be doubled in developed countries and expanded by 326% in developing countries to accommodate people. This is equivalent to building a city the size of Greater London every month for the next 40 years. Local governments will have to manage this growth and the severe strain it will put on municipal finances. They will also have to prepare for the resulting social inequality and make plans to reduce environmental degradation and deal with the effects of climate change. The fact that this population growth will occur largely in intermediate cities with little human resource capacity and limited budgets will compound the problem. Thus, a policy is needed if the trends in urbanization tend to be unproductive in terms of livelihoods and are characterized by slum growth and lack of basic urban services. A policy is needed for transforming urbanization as a source of wealth, reaping social and economic benefits, and managing and reducing negative externalities. Now we can discuss the recent issues of urban policy initiatives in various parts of the world. Some of the most important issues that urban planning has to respond to are relevant in all parts of the world, while others vary according to the nature of regional political economies. Common global issues include climate change, economic crisis, economic inequality, and cultural diversity, among others. Context-specific issues range from urban informality, poverty, and peri-urbanization in developing countries, through environmental pollution and urban shrinkage in transitional countries, to large ecological footprints and an aging population in developed countries. The first one is global urban planning issues. The various regions of the world are now highly interlinked in terms of economic activity, information flow, and population movement, giving rise to a common set of urban issues. At the same time, all parts of the world are also affected by global environmental change. While the nature of the impact of global environmental change varies across regions, it also presents a common issue to which planning needs to respond. The first such issue is that of climate change. In responding to the impacts of climate change, urban areas need to take action of two kinds. These are mitigation and adaptation. Mitigation consists of measures and policies designed to reduce the emission of greenhouse gases. Adaptation pertains to activities aimed at reducing the vulnerability or strengthening the resilience of cities to the effects of climate change. Both kinds of action require urban planning. Mitigation requires reducing the ecological footprint of urban areas, which includes a shift to the public transport-based movement and planning for more efficient, compact, and mixed-use city forms. Adaptive measures include relocating vulnerable settlements, improving drainage, hardening up of infrastructure systems, and preventing new developments in areas likely to be affected by sea level rise or floods. The second issue is that of global economic crisis. In 2008, the global economic crisis, occasioned by the instability of unregulated markets and banking systems, caused by neoliberal economic policies, was revealed. Consequently, many countries have moved into recession. This has adversely affected economic growth, employment, foreign direct investment, international aid and development programs in countries across the world, which means less funding will now be available for state-initiated urban and infrastructural projects. This in turn reinforces the need for governments to act in partnership with civil society and private sector actors on urban development. It also reinforces the need for a developmental role for governments as opposed to neoliberal approaches which assumed that the market on its own could solve most urban problems. Energy supply and impacts. While the price of petroleum is relatively low, the volatility of oil prices in 2008 showed that price is no longer a predictable factor and that in the long term, global oil supplies will begin to decline. The impact of carbon dioxide emissions from petroleum-driven vehicles on climate change is becoming better understood, and this will also have encouraged a switch away from oil-dependent cities. Such urban settlements will have to introduce forms of public transport and energy-efficient buildings, which have low-rise, high plot coverage area, and these are needed to be accommodated. Another issue is that of changing population size. Urban population growth and decline are to be found in all parts of the world. Although the latter is more common in the developed and transitional regions. In the developing regions, population growth through urbanization and natural increase is the dominant pattern, and it has been recognized that in Africa and Asia, urban growth rates will remain high for some time to come. In these parts of the world, much of this settlement is and will be informal, and incomes will be generated largely through the informal economy. This puts pressure on ever-increasing demand for affordable housing and basic amenities. Then, there is an issue of income inequality. The changing nature of urban labor markets, which shows growing polarization of occupational and income structures, has in part given rise to greater urban income inequality in all regions of the world. This in turn has given rise to urban areas with stark contrast between areas of wealth and poverty, with escalating crime levels fueling the desires by the wealthy to spatially separate themselves from the poor. The income inequalities in selected Asian economies can be observed from figure 2. The figure shows that for many cities in Asia, the income inequalities are either close to or higher than the Gini coefficient value of 0.4, which is defined by UN Habitat as International Alert Line, which shows that the threshold level beyond which the inequalities are intolerable and have adverse impact upon social and economic growth of the cities. The income inequality and spatial fragmentation are mutually reinforcing, leading to segregated and violent cities. Women, children, and the aged feel the brunt of these processes. The challenges for planning in addressing this issue are particularly difficult, as urban planning cannot counter market forces. Rather, planning has to seek ways to promote social integration and cohesion, perhaps through a quality public space system. Cultural diversity. Growing volumes of global migration has meant that cities and towns in all parts of the world have become much more multicultural. People from very different ethnic and religious backgrounds now live together in cities. This is making participatory processes around planning issues far more difficult. Cultural diversity has important implications for how built environments are managed. Planners need to seek the right balance between cultural groups attempting to preserve their identity in cities and the need to avoid extreme forms of segregation and urban fragmentation. Cultural mix also raises new demands on planners to mediate between conflicting lifestyles and expressions of culture. Conflicts around religious buildings, burial arrangements, ritual animal slaughter, and building aesthetics are the new issues which planners have to increasingly tackle. There is also a growing demand for planners to play a role in preserving built environment heritage and historically valuable urban areas and protecting them from intensive conversion or invasion by incompatible uses. Now we can discuss urban policy issues in developing countries. While developing countries are affected by the issues discussed in the previous section, they are also affected by a range of issues that are specific to these regions of the world. These are related with huge informal sector, the youth bulge, unmanaged urban growth, peri-urban areas, rising income inequality and poverty, the constraints on institutional and professional capacity, and the environmental issues. The urban areas of the developing economies are known to have huge informal sector, but as these economies are moving towards formalization of the cities, the formalization process frequently destroys livelihoods and shelter and serves to exacerbate exclusion, marginalization, and poverty. Therefore, an important policy initiative of the developing countries is to devise new forms of regulation that serve to protect both the rich and the poor, while at the same time guiding urban growth in efficient and sustainable directions. In this direction, urban policies of many of the developing countries are aiming at social protection for the urban poor, providing housing facilities and also demarking an area for the informal vendors. Besides, the bulk of new growth in rapidly urbanizing cities is taking place on the urban edge and in some parts is linking up existing settlements to form extended urban corridors. This form of growth presents a host of new planning issues in that much of this new settlement is informal, unserviced, fragmented, has a mix of tenure systems, and is beyond the boundaries of municipal governments. These areas are extremely difficult and expensive to service in the conventional way. The urban governments are therefore trying to find new and incremental approaches to service and infrastructure delivery in partnership with local communities. Another important challenge before the urban governments in the developing countries is that the demographic trend in cities and towns shows the increasing proportion of young people, that is those aged between 15 and 29 years, relative to the adult population. While the youth can form the most energetic and innovative segment of the population, where they also comprise the bulk of the unemployed, they can be a source of social unrest and deviance, including crime. Planning for a youthful population places particular demands on urban development in terms of the need for education and training facilities, and sport and recreational investments. It also raises demands to cope with the negative side of the youth bulge through a focus on safe public spaces and movement networks. Now let us discuss about urban policy issues in transitional economies. Planning issues in these parts of the world tend to be a combination of those found in developed and developing regions. These economies face the problem of aging population, leading to an increasing demand for healthcare and other facilities for the elderly, along with deteriorating tax base. Among other specific problems of these cities are the resource crunch due to inappropriate rules of the devolution of resources from the central governments, and the need for change in legislative framework for urban planning. Many transitional countries have now produced new planning legislation as the effects of a lack of planning become increasingly evident. Frequently, this new legislation reinforces the conventional master planning approach. But several countries adopted strategic planning in addition to master plans at the behest of international development agencies. Strategic planning has introduced new issues of city competitiveness, economic growth, municipal financial reform, improved quality of life, and citizen participation. Given that strategic plans are not legally recognized, their coexistence with master plans greatly complicates the legislative environment for planning. Now we can discuss the urban policy issues in developed countries. In these regions, high incomes and steady growth have helped to avoid certain urban issues experienced in developing and transitional countries, but have also brought a different set of urban planning problems. Apart from the environmental issues and aging population, the cities in the developed countries face the problems of socio-spatial inequalities and urban fragmentation. City competitiveness, the desire to attract foreign investment, and urban development, fueled by booming property market, have segregated many cities and towns into elite enclaves and sprawling middle-class suburbs. But the changing structure of labor markets has left many urban residents poor and unemployed, and deteriorated public housing estates now coexist with new urban mega projects. Achieving integrated and equitable urban environments is a major challenge for planners. If the developed countries as city governments have become increasingly complex and sophisticated entities managing large resource flows and budgets, so the problem of achieving integration between various line function departments and between different levels of government has increased. This is an important issue for planning as it relies on the relationship between functions and tiers in order to achieve spatial coherence and integration on the ground. Potentially, planning can play an important role in encouraging sectoral alignment and coordination if the function is correctly positioned within governance structures. Urban policy initiatives for prosperity of the city. Prosperity implies success, wealth, thriving conditions, and well-being, as well as opportunity. In any urban setting, a key question will arise: what are the essential conditions and elements that are required for a city to thrive or for an urban area to be described as prosperous or for well-being of the population. The UN Habitat 2012 defines prosperity as having five components. These are productivity. A prosperous city contributes to economic growth through productivity, generating income and employment that afford adequate living standards for the whole population. The next one is infrastructure development. A prosperous city deploys the infrastructure, physical assets and amenities, adequate water, sanitation, power supply, road network, information and communication technology, etc., required to sustain both the population and the economy. The third component is that of quality of life. Prosperous cities provide the social services, education, health, recreation, safety and security, etc., required for improved living standards, enabling the population to maximize individual potential and lead fulfilling lives. The fourth component is that of equity and social inclusion. A city is only prosperous to the extent that poverty and inequalities are minimal. No city can claim to be prosperous when large segments of the population live in abject poverty and deprivation. This involves reducing the incidence of slums and new forms of poverty. Prosperous cities are equitable and socially inclusive. The benefits and opportunities that come with a prosperous city are equitably distributed. A prosperous city ensures gender equality, protects the right of minority and vulnerable groups, and ensures civic participation by all in the social, political, and cultural spheres. The fifth component is that of environmental sustainability. The creation and redistribution of the benefits of prosperity do not destroy or degrade the environment. Instead, the city's natural assets are preserved for the sake of sustainable urbanization. These five components of prosperity are shown in shape of a wheel in Figure 3. Since shared balanced development is a crucial feature of prosperity, none of the dimensions must prevail over the others and all must be kept roughly equal for the sake of a smooth ride on the path of prosperity. For this balance, the role of the urban policymakers has assumed greater importance. We can see that the hub is made of the local urban power functions, both public, that is municipal and other institutions and agencies, laws and regulations including urban planning, and non-public, that is civil society, business, etc. They combine in a variety of ways according to local needs and conditions, with the synergies between them resulting in innovative institutional or policy practice. All for the sake of public interest and shared prosperity, we can observe from figure that each rim is influenced by policy interactions. It is only through the policy interactions that each of the rim interacts with each other for a balanced ride. UN Habitat suggests that the project for the city of 21st century is one of achieving balanced prosperity, implying making the wheel well-rounded with synergetic spokes and a dynamic hub. UN Habitat 2011 has conducted a survey for monitoring the recent urban policy initiatives and has established that the cities which have shown efficient governance have been successful in achieving the desired level of prosperity. The contribution of various factors in prosperity of the cities is shown in Figure 4. In the figure, we can see that the factors that create a favorable environment for the cities to prosper are effective urban planning and management, decentralization policies, and appropriate institutions, a system that creates equal opportunities for all, participation of civil society, elected local officials, a favorable business environment, access to basic amenities, and public transport and mobility. Most of these factors are interrelated or complementary and jointly affect the prosperity of cities. The perceived importance of urban planning is most pronounced in the Arab states, followed by Africa and Asia. However, in Latin America and the Caribbean, urban planning emerges as the third most important factor that creates an environment conducive for cities to prosper. The experience of most of the regions on urban policy initiatives has indicated that efficient urban planning, decentralization policies, and appropriate institutions, and the system that creates equal opportunities for all have proved to be most conducive factor in urban prosperity. On the other hand, poor governance and weak institutions, corruption, inadequate infrastructure, and high incidence of slums and poverty have proven to be the greatest impediments to the prosperity of the cities. The figure shows that poor governance and weak institutions act as major impediments to higher urban prosperity. The impact of poor governance and weak institutions on urban prosperity appears to be more pronounced in cities in Africa and Arab states, where over 40% of the experts cite this factor as the single most important impediment. Corruption is considered by the local experts as the second most important hindrance to enhanced urban prosperity, with Arab countries having the highest impact. Inadequate infrastructure is also a major impediment to the prosperity of cities. The impacts of deficient infrastructure appear to be more pronounced in Asian and African cities and less so in Arab states. So students, let us summarize what we have learned from this module. To sum up, it can be stated that the recent trends of urbanization are mainly located in the developing countries. These economies face huge challenges due to faster growth of urban population as compared to the growth of urban resources. Therefore, the urban policy initiatives have assumed greater importance in recent times. Major urban issues before the policymakers are managing climate change, inequalities, increased demand of urban amenities, increasing size of informal labor market, managing cultural diversity, etc. For mitigating these problems, many urban policies have been changed accordingly. But it is also being felt that poor urban governance, corruption, weak institutions, and inadequate infrastructure are the major challenges that pose threats to the desired outcomes of any urban policy initiative. Therefore, apart from framing policy for a specific objective, these impediments would also have to be cleared, and efficiency of the planning and implementation has to be ensured for sustainable prosperity of the cities. That's all with today's lecture. I hope you must have enjoyed it. Thank you.